Singh has just arrived in person. Are you going to be staying for the entire meeting? So I believe we have started the live stream and the webcasting. So Mr. Chair, I will pass the meeting over to you.
Thank you, Peter. As we begin today's meeting, we would like to acknowledge that we are gathering here today on the treaty territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. Before them, the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Huron, and Wendat. We also acknowledge the many First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and other global Indigenous people that now call Brampton their home. We are honored to live, work, and enjoy this land. Before we start today's meeting, I ask that we remember those who have passed or are suffering from COVID-19, and to also reflect and think of our various frontline workers, healthcare providers, and first responders who are working so hard to serve, protect, and care for us all. Please all rise now for the singing of our national anthem, to be followed by a moment of personal reflection. Welcome to our regular council meeting of October 14th, 2020. We will now begin the meeting with the city clerk calling the roll of attendance for today's meeting. Peter?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members of council, I will be calling your name for attendance. Councillor Dillon?
Here.
Councillor Singh is present. Councillor Fortini?
Here, present.
Councillor Williams?
I'm here.
Councillor Medeiros?
Here.
Councillor Bowman?
Present.
Councillor Pelleschi?
Present.
Councillor Vasante?
Present.
Councillor Santos?
Here.
And Chair Willens is present, so we have 10 members present with the mayor absent and to be attending a little later.
Thank you. We are now at the approval of the agenda, item 2 on the agenda. Does any member wish to add a business item to today's meeting? If so, please use the chat function to add your name to the speaker's list. And I see Councillor Dillon is on the list.
Sorry, may I go ahead?
Yes, go ahead, please.
All right. I just want to add a... I'm just having some technical difficulties here. A discussion item on the recent Indian farming protests in Brampton.
So through you, Mr. Chair, that would be under new business, proposed item 16.2.
Okay, thank you. Are there any more additions to the agenda? I don't see any. Peter, do we have any at your end?
Mr. Chair, we do not, other than to identify that the staff report identified on the published agenda 10.3.1, a safe restart agreement, phase two. That item's been withdrawn as the report will be presented to a future meeting.
Okay, thank you. So do we have a motion to accept the additions, Peter?
So Mr. Chair, if you can just ask for a motion and a seconder from the members, please.
Agony, Councillor Dillon, would you like to move it?
And Councillor Vicente is...
Councillor Vicente, sorry, Councillor Vicente, you can move it. Maybe Councillor Dillon, you can second it.
Sure.
Okay, great. So instead of seeking a recorded vote for this item, I will ask, is there anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will be counted in the affirmative. Thank you. I see no objections. Meetings of the municipal councils are to be open to the public for transparency and accountability, and our meeting will continue to be as well, with a few precautions and limitations. In-person attendance at this meeting is very limited. Members and most staff are participating electronically in this meeting. The public can still access and participate in the meeting in a number of ways. Watching this meeting remotely through the city's live stream and playback of the archived video stream, registering with the city clerk as a virtual delegate to participate in the meeting, registering to attend the meeting in person to observe the meeting, or submitting questions about the agenda business and decisions made by council today, emailing the city clerk's office at cityclerksoffice@brampton.ca with your question, which may be read into the public meeting record during the 15-minute public question period before ending of the meeting. Also, continue to follow important service and public updates through the city's website at www.brampton.ca, which include updated information of the city's response, as well as links to other important sources of information, including Region of Peel Public Health, Province of Ontario, and the Government of Canada. A final reminder to members of council before we start to consider today's agenda business, please ensure your video is off and your microphone is muted until you are assigned to the floor, then you can turn both on when you are asked. This will ensure only one person is speaking at a time and minimize other background disruptions during the meeting. We are now at item three, declarations of interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act. Does any member have a declaration of pecuniary interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act for any matter to be discussed on today's agenda? Seeing none, the clerk will so note the meeting's minutes. Item four, we are now ready to move to the next item of public business on today's council agenda, item four, the minutes. We have the following council minutes before us today: 4.1 minutes of the City Council regular meeting, September 30th, 2020, and 4.2 minutes of City Council special meeting, September 30th, 2020. Do any members have any questions or comments regarding the minutes? If so, please use the chat function to add your name to the speakers list. And I see no one in the chat. So there's nobody on the speaker's list, so could I get a motion by a councillor here to approve the minutes? Councillor Santos, thank you. Do we need a seconder, Peter? Yes, I guess we do. A seconder,
yes, we do.
Please.
You have Councillor Vicente as well.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will be counted in the affirmative. There are no objections, so the motion carries. The next item is item five, the consent motion. The items listed with a caret on the agenda are considered to be routine and non-controversial. The consent motion is to adopt these matters on today's agenda without the need for a separate discussion on the items unless a member requests a separate discussion. Does any member wish to add an item to consent? If so, please use the chat function and your name to the speaker's list. Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Chair, I'd like to add three items, item 10.5.1, as well as the closed session minutes, items 9.1 and 9.2.
Okay, thank you. The clerk will still note that. Are there any others?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
The closed session items, you can withdraw the one that's in the ward that you and I represent.
Okay. Peter, what is that item? Do you know? Just go there.
Through you, Mr. Chair, I believe you're referring to item 19.3. 19.3
okay.
Is not added to consent. So, Councillor Pelleschi, are you proposing to add that item to consent?
No, I was confused. Councillor Santos mentioned what was 9.1, 9.2. And I knew that 19, they were called 19, but I'm good.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Lesche. So if there's no objections, the motion carries. Are there any announcements today, Peter?
Through you, Mr. Chair, there are none.
Okay, we are now on our next item is government relations update, and we have a presentation 7.1 from Blaine Lucas, Senior Manager, Public Affairs, Office of the CAO. Welcome, Blaine.
Welcome. Thank you, and through the Acting Mayor, I'll begin with regional business. So if we can move forward to slide 2. All righty, perfect. This week is Community Week with both Government Relations Committee and the Strategic Housing and Homelessness Committee taking place on October 15th. Staff from the Public Affairs have reviewed both agendas for any comments or recommendations. While there are a number of four information reports, the majority are regional specific or have a low impact on regular city business. Where appropriate, we've also shared the agenda items with various departments. If we could proceed to slide number 3, please. Okay, if we can move forward to slide 3. Great, thank you. Alrighty. So in regards to the Government Relations Committee, specifically item 6.1, provides an update on the region's priority issues, which are listed here on the slide, as well as any upcoming advocacy opportunities. Where possible, the public affairs staff continually work with our regional government relations colleagues to share information and look for opportunities to advance the City of Brampton's priorities. Lastly, we just wanted to highlight that the Government Relations Committee will host a delegation from an MPP from Mississauga Centre who will update the committee on provincial initiatives. So the staff recommendation for item 6.1 on the regional agenda was to receive the report. If we could move forward now onto slide number 4. Great, thank you. Alrighty. So we're looking at the Strategic Housing and Homeless Committee. Item 5.3 on the regional agenda refers to Angeles Place, conversion to permanent housing in Mississauga. The report outlines the staff recommendation to use Angeles Place for permanent affordable housing for families experiencing homelessness. We recognize how important providing safe and affordable housing is to this council, and city staff continue to work with the region appeal to ensure we are identifying similar opportunities in Brampton. We can move forward to slide number 5. I'll go through the provincial items fairly quickly. As I know, the mayor and members of council and the city have been sharing information related to the provincial targeted public health measures in Peel that took effect on Saturday. Similar to the focus of council, the province outlined a number of steps to support businesses due to the revenue loss and impacts from the above restrictions. These supports include $300 million in funding to help with fixed costs, such as property taxes, hydro, and natural gas bills, introducing Bill 215, Main Street Recovery Act, in 2020, part of a $60 million Ontario Main Street Recovery Plan, which includes $1,000 grant for small businesses to cover the cost of PPE. Lastly, staff is looking at the new $9 million Reconnect Festival and Event Program, which provides non-capital funding for in-person and online events. All right, if we can move forward now to slide number 6. All right, the federal update. We're watching to see from the federal government is introducing legislation to support business experiencing revenue losses due to COVID-19, specifically the new Canada Emergency Rent Subsidy, the 25% top-up of Canadian Emergency Rent Subsidy for organizations, temporarily shut down by the by a mandatory public health order, extension of the Canada Emergency Wage Subsidy until June 2021, and expanded Canada Emergency Business Account. we could move forward now to our final slide, number 7. Here we have some exciting news to share. As the Federation of Canadian Municipalities Board of Directors, voting results have been announced, and Regional Councillor Santos has been elected to the Ontario Caucus. We'd like to extend our congratulations. We look forward to the vote ratification at FCM's annual general meeting to be held on October 15th. And that concludes our quick update from Public Affairs for today. If there's any questions from members of council, I'd be happy to do my best to answer them now.
Thank you, Blair. Is there any questions?
Through you, Mr. Chair, Councillor Pileschi has identified to speak. Sorry, Councillor Pileschi, you sent that just to myself. I just noticed that now.
Oh, ouch. Sorry about that. Go ahead, Councillor Pileschi.
Thank you, Mr. Acting Mayor. Congratulations, Councillor Santos. Exciting news. It's fantastic. We keep filling up those boards. We can do good things for Brampton for sure. Just some questions on the provincial government updates. I guess I was talking to Derek the other day, and I guess they've minimized the amount of kids that we can have in our hockey arenas, which puts that down to 10 per ice rink, and that limits that makes the teams then have to have three now practices to fill one practice per the whole team. So I guess the conversation that I've been having with some of the parents of kids that are on the ice, they're still paying the same amount, even though their child is now down to 1 hour. They haven't, Brampton Minor Hockey hasn't increased the amount of time they want to use the ice. But it limits their child from the amount of time that they're on the ice per week. So I guess, have we had that conversation with Brampton Minor Hockey or the candidates to see if they're looking for more ice to accommodate the whole team? And if so, are we looking to provide maybe a further discount? I know we discount their rates currently. Are we looking to provide a further discounted rate?
Through the chair, this is Derek speaking to Councillor Pileschi. So we're in constant contact with all the minor hockey organizations and associations. And off the top of my head, I haven't heard anything from staff where they've asked for more ice. We've with the recent regulations as of yesterday, we just started contacting permit holders. So I can follow up with you as I hear more to see if there are cancellations coming. I know that Brampton Hockey and the candidates at the beginning of the season were the ice that they requested was a lot less than usual, obviously to account for the lack of games, but I think also because of return to play guidelines that the associations have put in place. And so we haven't heard any complaints. I did check after the email you sent to me with my sports unit, and they haven't heard any complaints or any requests. But I will do a double check probably towards the end of the week, just as we get through this new recent announcement.
Okay, Derek. So I'm assuming that because it's starting to hit, the coaches are starting to talk now. Parents don't want to be, you know, paying. It's an expensive sport, as probably everybody knows. But they don't want to be paying for their child to play in practicing with limited amount of practice. They understand there's no games or anything now, but taking a team down to 10 when you currently only have maybe 1 or 2 hours per week, that doesn't put your child on the ice every week. So I guess the question I think would be coming out of Brampton Minor Hockey is for them to look for more ice time. And I guess I'm glad that we're going to be open to having that discussion and would like to know moving forward what the rate would be for each. On the recent announcement, the province and them
kind of slapping the wrists of restaurants and indoor gyms. I haven't heard of any viruses being contracted through restaurants in Brampton or gyms. And I saw in the news the other day in some social media posts that Georgetown's restaurants, bars, and gyms are now completely packed, which doesn't make real sense to me. I guess Toronto had more of the issue in the restaurants, but Blaine, do we even know or track that here just for Brampton for the for any current exposure that's been within the city, just for restaurants and gyms? Or does anybody know?
Through your chair, David here. So I'm not sure if Alain is on the line or Kim Kane acting for Chief Bill Boyce. My understanding, to answer your question directly, Councillor Pleshy, is we the city does not track that information. The region might, however. Certainly we can confirm that information and email it to you.
Okay, thank you. And if I don't believe that I think the region is tracking it, but I don't think they're publishing it. So it's unfortunate that, you know, the restaurants, bars, and gyms in Brampton, from my understanding, where there's been no COVID cases, are feeling the brunt of this, when I don't even think that this isn't going to be the end of it. It may do something a little bit better for Toronto, but if then they lighten the restrictions, I think at the end of the month, then we're just going to be back into the same boat and kind of wave three and more modified two. So those were my comments. Thank you, Mr. Acting Mayor.
Councillor Pleshy, it's Mayor Brown. I'm now on the call. I just completed our weekly press briefing in the media studio. And this is something I actually spoke about today, so I'm glad you're asking about it. I don't think it's something that Blaine could answer, but it is a frustration we highlighted, not only myself, but Mayor Crombie and Mayor Thompson, that we were disappointed with the provincial changes. We had asked for banquet halls to be curtailed, because that's where we saw some large gatherings still occurring. We didn't expect it to happen in recreation or restaurants, because we haven't had any forward transmission. Just today, Dr. Lowe spoke about it again, saying we haven't had a single case from a restaurant. I guess the provincial worry was that people from Toronto would go and dine in Peel Region. For me, that argument is tenuous at best, because why not Vaughan or Durham? We are seeing a higher hospital utilization, so that may be a sign that things are about to get worse. We've conveyed our concerns to the province. The night before it happened, I was on the phone at 11 o'clock at night with the premier expressing my reservations. And I understand why it happened in Toronto. They've had significant transmission from restaurants and their nightlife area. But that's not the picture in Peel Region. And we're in Toronto, they've lost contact tracing. We still have contact tracing in Peel Region. We know where the transmission's been. And so I'm glad you asked this question, because it speaks to the frustration that I've highlighted. As you probably know, I was on BNN and CP24 and CTV talking about this. And I hope that when this 28 days is up, we're not going to be looped in with Toronto again for what is ever after that, because we do have a different dynamic in Peel Region than there is in Toronto.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And no, I wasn't throwing a question out to Blaine other than the tracing, but I really just wanted to highlight how disappointed we are. I didn't catch your BNN or CP24 coverage, but you know that back in February, I asked for not only the borders to be shut down, but to completely shut down the province. And I think that they did that phase one where there was kind of a shutdown. But unfortunately, I think if we keep doing these modified phase shutdowns, we're just dragging this out. We're prolonging the fact that I still stand here today to say we need a complete shutdown for 2, maybe even 3 weeks, so that we can try and
funnel this thing out. And even then, it's not 100% because of the amount of border crossers that we're still getting today. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
And Councillor Pelleschi, you make a good point. If you had a complete shutdown, that's not going to eliminate transmission. If you look at the people that are getting if you look at where we've had outbreaks, it's in essential workers. So we have 11,000 people in the transportation logistics sector. We have truckers going across the border every day. We wouldn't have food on our shelves if it wasn't for them. And Dr. Lowe said they've been acquiring COVID south of the border. You know, we had an outbreak at a food processing plant in your ward at the beginning of this pandemic. We had a COVID cases emerge in Amazon that's responsible for 80% of the packaging of their product in Canada. Like, I'm sorry, but our essential workers are integral to Canada's supply chain. And these essential workers, Canada can't shut down their work because we're dependent upon them for food security. We're dependent upon them for supply chain. And so, if anything, I think people should be thanking Brampton for the sacrifice that so many of our residents are making for their own health, for the betterment of Canada. But that's my two cents.
No, thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I agree with you 100%. Thank you.
We have a motion here for government relations, moved by Councillor Pelleschi, seconded by Councillor Vicente. An update on government relations matters to the council meeting of October 14th be received.
A point of order.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Is there a board? Because yes. I joined late, I don't have the list.
I believe it was Councillor Williams after Councillor Pelleschi.
Oh, okay. So my apologies. When you sign on, you only see the most recent chat. You don't see any previous. So the clerk will inform me. We have Councillor Williams next. Is that correct?
Through you, Mr. Chair. I did not see any other councillors after Councillor Pelleschi. So if I did hear Councillor Williams and Councillor Santos.
Yeah, that's yes. The correct order, Mr. Mayor. Councillor Williams, then Councillor Santos. It's on my screen.
Okay. Okay, Councillor Williams.
Thank you. Through you, Mayor. I have some questions and comments about the confusion that is happening currently around dance studios. On the October 9th release from the province, it named dance studios to be one of the areas that needs to close. However, in a further release, dance studios were not considered, were not named on the list. And so many dance studios are really concerned. You know, they have been raising awareness to let everyone know they are a sport. It is considered a sport. And if sports teams are able to convene and practice, then dance studios should be able to do the same. The concern is many of the dance studios, they are adhering to the 10 people maximum, and they have all of their dancers dancing in their own square, socially distanced, in larger dance studios as well. So the question is, which one is it? Are they to open or are they to close? And keeping in mind that dance studios, they are considered a sport, but they're also a business and they're in the arts, and many of them are facing the risk of closing because they've had to had difficulties with, you know, paying rent to keep their doors open, and also recruitment, and also now currently this new release that is very unclear. So through the mayor to Blaine, do you have any clarity for the dance studios that you can provide today based on what the province is saying?
So Charmaine, in fairness, I don't think Blaine could answer that. I've been frustrated that the dance studios were included in this, so I've been advocating to the province about this. The ruling that I got last night was that, believe it or not, the dance studios with less than 10 people and more than 2 meters of physical space could stay open. Then okay. I got a reinterpretation this morning saying that they are included and that they can't be open unless it's for day camps. We've asked for a further clarification because Dr. Lowe and Paul Morrison believe that it's been a little bit convoluted. Unfortunately, the province included them in the areas where they specified specific closure, and then a later part of the regulations talked about the 10 people with less than maintaining 2 meters apart. But I don't think anyone would disagree. There hasn't been a single case of transmission in dance studios. It makes no sense for them to be closed. That's why I've been advocating to the province on this. And so I'm glad you brought it up, because you've echoed what I've been saying in the media, just in my press conference today. Actually, I was speaking about this exact topic, and I gave the example of Jade's Dance Academy. You know, they're paying $11,000 a month rent. There might be help for restaurants right now. There's no help for these dance studios. Do you want to see kids' recreation go under? Do you want to see dance studios go under? Well, this is a recipe for it. And I highlighted Dance Academy because they poured their heart and soul into building a successful business that was even featured, I think, on the Ellen DeGeneres show. Like, this is a local success story. It's for kids' mental health. They need this for...
Exactly.
And there's no reason for it to be closed. And so I'm going to continue my advocacy, and I welcome any member of council that wants to help with that advocacy. And I know Paul Morrison, our director of bylaw enforcement, and Dr. Lowe are speaking to the province about this. But this is not a Brampton decision. This is the province of Ontario decision. So we need to get in the premier's ear. It's not something that is a decision of our local staff.
Well, thank you so much for that advocacy, because many dance studios are saying that their parents are saying their kids have been doing much better since dancing again, when they've been able to open over the summer and up to now. So this is a huge blow to our community and city of Brampton. And dance is a sport. They have to practice, just like hockey, just like soccer. They have to practice in order to perfect their skill. And these young dancers right now are going to be stuck behind, and it's really just going to devastate many of our young boys and girls who have a passion for this art. And so there are a number of parents and studios who are starting the advocacy, writing letters. Mary Brown, do you have any other advice or any other things that we can do to help move this along? Because another closure for any longer than this week really is going to set many of these studios back. So, and is it possible to get some kind of timeline from Dr. Lowe with regards to feedback, so that we can, you know, get these kids back in the studio and in their dance shoes soon?
Thank you, Councillor Williams, and agree with your sentiments completely. And you know, we just need to rally our voices to the province to make sure that we're being heard. I know I've been inundated with emails as well from dance studios, from families, from parents, and you know, I believe the facts are on our side. There hasn't been a single case, but this applies not just for dance studios, for other recreation, for other small businesses like restaurants. You know, we haven't had a case in we haven't had a forward transmission in recreation or restaurants. And for me, that's very frustrating. Everything that's been done before has been data driven, and this is not data driven.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so to clarify, they have listed dance studios as one of the locations that cannot open, and currently right now we're waiting to hear from Dr. Lowe to know whether or not we can.
So we're not waiting Dr. Lowe. Dr. Lowe, the province has said that these are closed.
What these we're are asking, closed, okay.
And what we're advocating for, is there any wiggle room? It appears in the regulations, it looks like that day camps and training is permitted, and so we're trying to see if that's applicable for dance studios. Right now, the ruling is no, but we know the province said there were some errors in their regulations, and they're updating it today. Okay. And so we're hopeful that we're going to get maybe this was one of the errors. And you know, I would just say keep in touch with Paul Morrison. He's going to hear it from the province first, and I know Dr. Lowe has echoed this as well.
Okay, great. Thank you. No further comments or questions.
Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor, I echo many of the concerns that my colleagues have shared about the unfairness of some of these closures. and will say that I know people who are, instead of lining up for gyms and studios in Brampton, are going to Milton or Oakville to line up to go to their gym. So regardless of whether or not we close in Toronto, Brampton, Mississauga, the reality is that people will find their way elsewhere into other municipalities where it isn't closed. But I did want to just say thank you very much to my colleagues for the congratulations of being elected to the FCM board. It's going to be ratified tomorrow, and I worked very hard over the past 2 weeks making phone calls, emails, social media campaigns, etc., text messages to the delegates across the province so that Brampton can have a seat at the table. And through many of those discussions with all of the various delegates, I will say that the issues that we all share are consistent with those in rural Ontario as well as in larger cities like Brampton. And I'm very much looking forward to sharing many of the best practices that we have been doing in Brampton, but also bringing back some learning and making sure that we advocate for Brampton at that table as well. Big thank you to the team who worked hard over the past couple of weeks. I will kind of just flag that moving forward, unfortunately, at this particular FCM, we didn't have any Peel delegates or Brampton delegates to vote. And so most of the convincing and phone calls were to convince other municipalities to support delegates from Brampton who are running. So I will flag that moving forward to my council colleagues, it's so important for us as a city to be participating in these various events, and just want to flag that for the future. So again, thank you, everyone.
Did you want to speak to this first? Or David?
Oh, I'm sorry, Mayor Brown. My computer cut out there. Can you just repeat that, sir?
Mayor Brown, I'll move the government relations report or second it.
Councillor Santos, was there something specific you wanted answered, though?
No, I just said that moving forward with respect to FCM or AMO, that we need to make sure that councillors register for these events, because both at AMO and at FCM, Brampton had to convince other municipalities to vote for Brampton delegates. We didn't have anyone necessarily voting for the Brampton candidates.
Yeah, and so maybe Blaine, if we could have going forward, just if you could ensure, speak to every councillor to make sure they get registered, because I know there was a deadline this year, and unfortunately a lot of people that wanted to participate weren't able to, fortunately it worked out. Congratulations, Councillor Santos. We have a representative on the FCM board, and now we have one on the AMO board too with Paul Vicente, and of course Councillor Doug Willens, who is eager to serve as well as on the helping us on the Covenant of Global Mayors. And I know he represented the city at their meeting a year ago in Montreal. And so it's great that we have a larger voice for Brampton. We need to make sure that we seize every advantage. And so maybe if you could call and email every office next time to make sure we don't miss any deadlines. Is that something you can take under control, Blaine?
Yeah. To Mayor Brown, yes, of course. We can make sure that we notify everyone and then follow up with some phone calls and emails to let people know the voting process. And I just wanted to throw one thing in, sir. My computer kicked out on me, so if you heard some dead silence there to the members of council, it wasn't intentional. I've been trying to get my computer to cooperate, so I apologize for that.
Okay, no worries. That happens. It's we're in the technological age right now for meetings, and there's always hiccups. Councillor Santos, congratulations again. We have a motion moved by Councillor Pelleschi, seconded by Councillor Vicente, that the update for the government relations at the council meeting of October 14th be received. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. And thank you, Councillor Willens, for chairing the meeting while I was delayed with the press briefing. Next up is public delegations. We have a consultant presentation from NMP LLP, the Value for Money Audit of Brampton B Sponsorship Agreement.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And I just introduced this real quick. This is a referred matter from 2018, and MNP was hired to complete a value for money audit on the sponsorship agreement. So Jeff and Jason and Deepak are here to just present council with a short overview of their findings. The report is attached on the agenda as item 10.5.2. So I'll turn it over to Jeff to start with presentation.
Thank you, Derek, and thank you, Mr. Mayor, and good morning to City Council and staff. It's a pleasure to be here. So my name is Jeff Rodriguez. On behalf of MNP, I'll be leading the presentation over this engagement, but I do have two of my colleagues in the meeting as well that will participate when necessary. So in terms of the presentation itself, this relates to an engagement that we were hired to do just over a year ago with the City of Brampton. It was entitled Value for Money Audit, specifically relating to a sponsorship agreement that the city had with the Brampton Beast. So with that, I'll dive into the presentation and then certainly happy to take any questions that you may have at the tail end. So with that, if we can move to the next slide. So the agenda for this presentation, as Derek mentioned, there is the comprehensive and fulsome report that had been provided within the package. We've prepared this high-level overview just to give you some of the key elements that that were within the report itself. So first, I'll start off with some introductions because I do recognize this is the first time we're presenting on this matter. We'll be going through the audit background and really the objectives of what we wanted to get out of conducting this engagement. Talk a little bit about the scope in terms of what we looked at, and obviously the conclusion in terms of what we had arrived at. Really, the key part of this engagement, even going into it, working with Almanese's at the time, what we wanted to get out of it was really a look forward and a path forward to identify what are some of the lessons learned that we could garner from a sponsorship agreement of this nature in order to certainly help the city in future arrangements or sponsorship agreements that they would enter into. And then obviously we'll take any questions and answers at that time. So with that, if we can move to the next slide. Just by way of very brief introduction, this engagement was conducted by three members of our team, including myself. So really my role on the engagement was to be the lead partner driving it. I've been a partner with MNP since 2008. However, I've been in the public practice for over 20 years, primarily working with public sector organizations, all three levels of government, as well as agencies, boards, commissions, municipalities, and the other, the broader public sector. My role with MNP is I do lead the internal audit and internal controls practice for Eastern Canada. Happy to have the team members supporting me on this being Jason Ducharme. Jason is our regional public sector niche consulting leader. He's also our value for money technical expert. And Deepak Jaswal is a manager on my team that really conducted the brunt of the engagement and really led the delivery in the field. And as I said, they'll be speaking at relevant times within the presentation. So with that, we'll go to the next slide. At a very high level, I recognize that this engagement was over a year ago, so some of the information might be dated. But really, what the impetus was for this engagement was there was a three-year sponsorship agreement in place with the Brampton City Council and the Brampton Beast. The intent of the agreement at the time, just to refresh memories and really bring light to the engagement, is it was intended to help mitigate the Brampton Beast's predictive financial losses. Essentially from staying within the city of Brampton, they were looking for some assistance in terms of mitigating whatever losses they might have as a result of being within the city and not elsewhere. The aim of the agreement was really to help the Brampton Beasts continue their operations and at the same time promoting the city of Brampton through purchasing of certain advertising and sponsorship opportunities to really, improve the brand awareness or increase the footprint that we have within the city and really act towards helping with hospitality, tourism, and just generating revenue for the city. So that was our understanding in terms of the intent of the agreement, and that's what we kind of looked at it in terms of the perspective around, well, what was the agreement really, generating for the city as a result? So having said that, when talking with Almanese's at the time around what kind of engagement would really give you the results that you were looking for, What we arrived at was conducting something called a value for money audit. And public sector is also referred to as performance auditing. And really what it does is it looks at any major agreements or arrangements, and at a very high level, really looks at three areas of, I guess, success, being economy, efficiency, and effectiveness. We call them the three E's. I'll get into in a few moments, I'll get into really what that means. But really what the intent of the value for money audit was to do was to determine whether tangible benefits were realized, and really estimate those benefits against the $1.5 million investment that was to be made by the city in three installments over a three-year period. In terms of the scope and what we would, or objectives, what we would actually look at was, first of all, we looked at the agreement itself, just to ensure that contractual terms were actually being met as indicated. We looked at the impact of the agreement on the city and were there tangible benefits as a result. We did do an estimate as much as possible around the return on investment that was garnered for that. We also looked at any qualitative, I guess, results that came out of the sponsorship agreement that really heightened the awareness and the brand within the city itself. And then, as I said earlier, looked to provide you with any lessons learned and some tips and tools going forward with other sponsorship agreements. With that, if we can go to the next slide, the detailed scope around what we had looked at really was, I would say, in three buckets or phases. First of all, we took a detailed look at the agreement itself and really obtained an understanding in terms of what it was intended to achieve. We interviewed key stakeholders within the city, within council, and also with external stakeholders like the CAA Center. And we reviewed and analyzed the agreement as well as other supporting information. As I mentioned earlier, we conducted the engagement with three criteria in mind, being economy, whether best prices were obtained for the agreement, efficiency, were the maximum benefits achieved at the lowest cost possible, and then effectiveness, were the objectives of the agreement actually achieved. So what I can conclude is, while it appears that the contractual terms were in agreement, and being met, we were really unable to definitively say whether sufficient value was obtained. And the reason being is really threefold. What we had found was, at the time, there was no independent city data available to verify that the advertising placements and sponsorship opportunities were actually being met. No data had been collected by the city at the time to really inform what the quantitative and qualitative benefits were coming out of the agreement. And essentially, we did not find that the city actually performed any market analysis in terms of this opportunity against other similar level of investment opportunities, and whether there were other, I guess, more tangible alternatives available that would result in better results. So what that really led us to do was provide you with some lessons learned in terms of what can be done going forward. If we can move to the next slide, I will just at a high level go over what those lessons learned are. So really, we bucketed it into four key areas. Being vendor effectiveness, having in place criteria for evaluating sponsorship agreements, looking at realization of agreement benefits or post-benefits realization, as we call it, and then finally reporting. So within the vendor effectiveness piece, what we had suggested to the city was, going forward with any major agreements, you really should have a program in place around vendor performance. And what that vendor performance program would be is it would have tools and mechanisms in place to actively monitor the vendor and manage the vendor against the agreement. There should be identified key points of contact within the city to really oversee and champion the agreement, which would really foster better coordination and collaboration with the external stakeholder or the party being funded, as well as putting in place performance update meetings to keep the city apprised of how the agreement's going. Really, the intent is to identify, address, and manage any potential risks, as well as sharing common information around how is the agreement working, are we seeing the tangible benefits that we intended, and then really at the end of the day, putting in place key performance indicators to monitor that vendor performance. In this case, that would have been the Brampton Beast. In terms of the criteria for evaluating sponsorship agreements, some of the things that we look to in terms of these sponsorship arrangements is brand synergies. So entering into arrangements with organizations or stakeholders that really share the same core values as the city itself. Looking for mutual benefits, really to enhance the city's business and generate additional revenues for the city. Considering hospitality options, like, are the costs really aligned with what the city standards would be for that, something of that nature. Looking to brand eminence. So are the advertising mediums and options available really aligned with what the city's practices or intent are? And then finally, key metrics. So are outcomes being achieved and are they being captured and measured? In terms of the realization of the agreement benefits or post-benefits realization, we look for really at the end of the day outcomes. This is outcome-based funding. So did the agreement or is the agreement achieving its intended objectives against the actual results? Is there a clear purpose around what the sponsorship is intended to do? Are there mechanisms in place to measure the achievement of those objectives? And then is there tracking and recording of the results of those benefits? Next is the worth and the value that's coming out of it, or the value for money per se. This really has to do with having market research mechanisms in place to really understand the value of those services. Are they really known, and are the planned outcomes really lined up with what the intended outcomes should have been? And then finally, on the reporting piece, and this is really critical because this is the information and communication piece, to raise that awareness within the city council in terms of, are we getting our best bang for our buck? Are we generating tangible benefits? Having the right information systems in place, systems really for measuring results, putting in place some feedback loops or mechanisms like surveys. So conducting some external surveys around, is the agreement generating the effectiveness that it was intended? In the sponsorship agreement itself, there could have been external surveys being conducted to say, is the Brampton Beast really generating awareness for the city, and is there adequate market penetration? And then finally, reporting. And this is reporting up to city staff as well as the council to really being provided with regular and ongoing information around the agreement, reviews on those reports, and then that way the city council can really make decisions around how they want to conduct the agreement going forward. Are there actions or recalibration as necessary throughout? Those at the high level are really the lessons learned. Details really are within the report itself in terms of action steps around that. At this point in time, what I'd like to do is turn it over to Jason Ducharme and obviously Deepak. Jason being our value for money expert that led the technical piece to this, I'm sure he's got a lot more context or clarity that he can provide. So with that, Jason, if I could turn it over to you.
For sure. Thanks, Jeff. Actually, I think you did a pretty good job. So my comments will be pretty brief. I think the key lesson here is that if the city is going to invest, $1.5 million of taxpayers' dollars, the onus is to make sure that you hold that vendor accountable for all the things that they promised in their proposal. It in a way, sponsorships are really no different than if you hired a contractor to build a road. You have all kinds of processes to make sure that that contractor meets the specs, that they deliver the road, and they do a good job. In the same way, a sponsorship, you need to have those kinds of processes in place to make sure that the things that are promised actually materialize. And that was the key lesson learned here. If you go forward and are considering other sponsorships, put in place independent ways of measuring the actual payback that you get on that sponsorship.
Thank you, Jason. And then I guess before I turn over to questions and answers, Deepak, is there anything that you wanted to add?
Good morning, everybody. No, I think you guys have covered it well, and I do apologize if I'm sporadically coming in and out. I was trying to speak a little earlier. Unfortunately, the connection just kind of intermittently disrupts itself. But I think yourself and Jason covered it all, Jeff.
Great. So thank you for your time. And obviously, I'll turn over now for any questions or commentary that the city might have.
Okay, well, thank you for this work. And although this decision with the Brampton Beast predates this council, I know this is something that we've taken an interest in, making sure that taxpayers get value for money. And let me just say, this is disappointing. You never like to see taxpayer dollars not being used to the fullest potential extent to the benefit of residents. And I hope the city learns from this, that we don't have mistakes like this in the future. First up, we got a number of people that want to speak. First up is Councillor Martin Medeiros.
Thank you, Mayor Brown. Through you, Mayor, I guess before I get into some questions, this is like the gift that keeps on giving, Brampton Beast. And, it was interesting last term of council, we had a councillor who would always refer back to decisions made by previous councils, and he would scruffly and say, I wish those councillors were back here to see what their decisions were made. And, I guess fortunate or unfortunate, I know there are some of my colleagues here who are big supporters this agreement. And notwithstanding at the time, many of what's been brought up as issues were exactly why I, amongst others, were against this agreement. Basically, when you talk about taxpayers' money and we go through scrutinizing community groups who receive $5,000, $10,000, and the way that we threw money at this agreement, really is probably one of the lessons and probably one of the worst ways that, you know, this council or previous council did in throwing that money, which was unaccountable for, which was now to tell us that there's no way to prove if there was advertisement. It almost gets to a point that it's criminal what was done with the money. And I don't know, you know, what options we would have to go after, you know, this organization for that money. That's something, I guess, that we consider. But, you know, certainly when you think of the origins of this agreement, what, and I heard this talk about brand association. That was a point that we talked about before, is the and also investment in sort of this, you know, notwithstanding, understanding that the hockey team needed help, but not with the taxpayers' money. But I just find it very rich when we're sort of discussing details and looking at our own budgets and looking at $5 and questioning all this other stuff. But yet, you know, there was a decision to give $1.5 million. And this report, where what troubles me as well, that a year later comes back, because I guess staff who worked on this weren't around. So we can't put them to their feet to the fire. And, you know, and certainly with our new CAO and a new team dedicated to advertisement, you know, certainly I won't, you know, put it on them and they have to inherit this. But, you know, going forward, I guess, you know, a couple of questions I have for Mr. Rodriguez and his team. So one was, you know, what really stands out from you from the report? You know, and I know there's a bunch of, and I know you guys coddled the language to, you know, be somewhat diplomatic, but essentially there's no proof of an advertisement with the city of Brampton. Is that correct?
Thank you. And through the mayor, I'll start out and then Deepak and Jason certainly jump in. I think the essence of what we had found within the engagement and the work we had done was there really was no internal monitoring or collection or maintenance of internal data that would indicate that certain things, as per the agreement that were intended to be done, were actually being done. What we ended up having to do is we had to go around, I would say, go through the back end and confirm either via through records of the Brampton Beast or with the CAA Center. We had to find other means to determine whether the contractual terms were being met. At the end of the day, it was good to note that it appeared the terms were being met. The challenging or the troubling thing was we weren't able to get to that answer looking at the city's data, because that data just did not exist. There was no maintenance or record keeping of what was being done, at least on the city's end. Deepak, I know you were closer to the details. Is that a fair representation?
I think that is very fair, and I do apologize if I'm repeating anything, because again, my connectivity is a bit intermittent. But a prime example, Mr. Mayor, would kind of be one of the contractual advertising placements was a large graphic on the side of the team bus. With respect to that, I mean, there was no consideration in terms of the time of travel, consideration in terms of visibility and weather conditions. It would have been quite easy for the city to really purchase a billboard in the respective cities that the team was touring, which could be seen 24 hours a day. So what we were really seeing is, you know, while, the team could actually take a picture of the logo on the team bus, and, you know, there are still parameters even around doing that, that maximum value was not being achieved by the city. So unfortunately, we had to place a lot of reliance on what was provided to the city. So I think the crux of it was is that no independent monitoring was taking place by the city to ensure that maximum value was being obtained.
Yeah, so, I mean, we were receiving attestations or assurances from the Brampton Beast that certain things were being done. However, we couldn't independently verify or validate that, because that information did not exist within the city's own internal records.
So essentially, through you, Mayor, to MNP, MNP, my apologies. So staff, we were presented with a sort of a midterm report in last term of council, which was, or giving us an update, I think after the first year or second year. And again, I don't know if you had access to this information, but the fact that, you know, staff were no longer there, who worked on this, you had trouble then getting information from the city. So there was really no, sorry, either there was no information being shared or passed on or carried, or simply there was no tracking whatsoever. So it was just everyone's now, you know, pointing at each other or looking at each other. And essentially we had all this money go out. So wouldn't, and again, I don't know, wouldn't staff as a best practice or through your experience with the municipalities, wouldn't after 1 year, if they can't sort of, if there's sort of information that is not being brought in by the organization, shouldn't that have been brought to council's attention?
Through the mayor. So certainly, you know, I'll let Jason speak as well, but I would say, in my opinion, yes. Especially if it's a multi-year arrangement, being a three-year agreement with annual installments, you would certainly hope by at least the end of the first year, there's some kind of progress report in terms of, and specific tactical results, right? In terms of this is what the agreement said we were going to get out of it, this is what we actually received from it, and this is the inherent value or outcomes that we had seen. In a typical vendor performance management or sponsorship agreement monitoring program, that would be expected. And that kind of reporting should go up to City Council, I would say at least annually. I would say that is a key lesson learned coming out of this. Jason, I don't know if you want to add any color or thoughts on that as well.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. You know, he asked us what stands out from our report is the lack of proof. The interesting thing is that there was an economic study, a short economic study done prior to the sponsorship that talked about things like, well, there's going to be hotel stays in town, there's going to be new visitors, there's going to be taxes. So it might be that there was all kinds of benefits out there that did happen in those sorts of things. But the trouble is, if you don't measure it, you can't actually attest to it. You can't say, here's what we got back, because there wasn't a measurement process in place to actually see whether or not those things were happening.
And one of the key measurements you would look to see, and within the report, it's in Appendix D, one of the outcomes you would expect from one of these arrangements is to see additional generation of revenue. And we translated that into, well, what are the attendance at Brampton Beast games? Are they, you know, presumably they should be increasing if there's a lot of advertising and sponsorship happening. What we found in the three-year period of the arrangement, the attendance at Brampton Beast games were actually declining. So it was actually working in the opposite direction. So obviously, tangible benefits were not being seen because there were less people coming out to games versus more.
Wow. So, and I guess for you, Mayor, just in terms of another question, have you ever seen this type of agreement that municipalities have engaged with regarding sports sponsorships? Is this something, have you ever looked at this before? Is this the first one you've ever looked at the City of Brampton?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Jason, I think first I'll defer to you because I know you've got a lot more broader coverage around municipalities and regions. I mean, it's the first one I've seen, but Jason, I know you've got a lot more experience in this area.
There are other sponsorships, particularly when it comes to, you know, new facilities, new arenas, and trying to get things going. The practices, I think, vary in terms of how disciplined the municipalities are about ensuring that they get what was promised. I do know that there are certainly ways in which the private sector monitors the return on sponsorship. So, for instance, MNP, we sponsor the Blue Jays, and we've got a team of people that track the number of people that go out to games, the number of events, the number of views, like on TV, how many people saw our sign, right? And they track that kind of stuff. So there's certainly precedent for sponsorship agreements and estimates of return of the benefits from the sponsorship agreements that are out there.
Yeah, and just lastly, and you may not be able to respond, but what is quite evident and somewhat defense of staff, and this is sort of a lessons learned, is that, you know, there was a lot of political pressure on staff for this agreement. So a motion that gets passed, money that gets good money, good taxpayer money, get being thrown at a bad situation. And the political pressure was such that staff were almost in an impossible situation, knowing that, you know, and this goes as a lessons learned that, you know,
staff have to stay resilient and provide the best information, best advice, and succumb sometimes, or you know, be strong against political pressure, because you know many of the stuff that you're raising, those are exactly comments that I and many others who oppose this agreement had raised. And unfortunately, here we are now. You know, people are no longer here. Some people are, and but certainly, I think this was a good example of you know, strong political pressure. Staff put it in a possible situation. Then they do their best. There's not forthcoming with information, and now we have this sort of landmine of a report that certainly is embarrassing to this municipality, and a report, especially on the face of, you know, being in council, listening to what we put community organizations through the hoops for $5,000-$10,000, and when we put other organizations and anyone that we try to give, even going through our own expense account to provide a $300 sponsorship, I probably have to answer more questions to provide a sponsorship to community groups than what basically this council or previous council did with this $1.5 million. It's really a sad day. It's a negative day. It's a, you know, notwithstanding, but I think there's a lot of lessons learned, and I appreciate all the information that you brought forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next up on our list is Councillor Dillon.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think Councillor Medeiros had covered all the points that I was going to mention, but if you recall, during the last term when this issue had arose, you know, it's probably one of the most peculiar decisions that I had seen or experienced. The Brampton Beast was losing about $4 million, I believe, in its just its first 3 years of operation. They had went to Hamilton for a similar type of agreement, which I believe they were in Hamilton before, which Hamilton Council rejected. And so essentially we gave $1.5 million of tax money. In the argument at that time, I know as myself, I think Councilor Medeiros as well, was that it could go to something better. There's no checks and balances in place. We asked numerous times as to how we're going to be able to measure it. We weren't given an answer. And so there was a number of community groups, a number of different initiatives that the money could have went to. And I guess what was odd was that just a little while after, subsequently, they had put about a 50% stake of the team for sale. And so, which led to the question, if we were going to put $1.5 million for sponsorship, you know, why wouldn't we just buy the team? And so, you know, at that time I'd said, you know, gains are privatized, risks were socialized. And essentially they got $1.5 million. They were bleeding. You know, as MNP just stated, they, you know, actually their ticket sales declined. So it's an unfortunate situation, and I guess what it is a learning lesson going forward, and that we have to be mindful of taxpayer money when we, you know, do such types of sponsorship deals, and we've got to make sure we have the checks and balances in place to be able to be accountable to the residents and their taxpayers. So just want to thank MMP for their. For their work and bringing this report forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Dillon. Next up, Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor, I share the same sentiments as Councillor Medeiros and Councillor Dillon. I do want to acknowledge Councillor Singh for actually being the one to bring the motion forward to prompt this report and this somewhat of an investigation, I would put it in, into the situation. And thank you, MNP, for helping clarify what happened with the taxpayers' $1.5 million. I was not part of the previous council or term that made this decision, but I'm certainly happy that we now have a process in place regarding sponsorships, and I'm sure that with that team we will be far more accountable and measured in how we go into situations with sponsorships in the future. I just wanted a little bit of clarification from staff in terms of the original decision, original recommendation from staff on that, on this. I believe the recommendation from the original report was not to proceed with the sponsorship. That is my understanding. Is that correct?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, to Councillor Santos. So this predates my time at the city as well, so I had to do some digging and research. But in the reports that I read in February 29th, 2016, there is a report from the Director of Business Services at the time that does say that this the proposal is not economically feasible. And in discussions with staff that were around at the time, it does appear that staff were against that. And to Councillor Medeiros's comments earlier, it appears in my research that it was directed, it was a direction from council, but it does not appear that staff were in support of this based on the council reports that I've read.
Okay, thank you very much for that, and perhaps some of the other councillors who were part or privy to that debate can chime in and clarify further as to whether or not that original report was indeed in the negative in terms of supporting the sponsorship agreement. One thing, I'll share a story, then I have a comment. I went to a pet store last year and to get stuff for my dog, and I saw at the cashier's register that there was this huge stack of Brampton Beast tickets just sitting there. And I asked what they were, and they said, oh, well, these are hockey tickets. Take as many as you want. Nobody seems to be taking them. And so your report is consistent with that particular story that I share. One final thing that I would like to just mention is that when we as councillors delve deep into line by line items on various procurement reports that come to council for a few thousand dollars here and there, particularly when it comes to hiring consultants and contractors, I think we all will have to look back at this $1.5 million and how unaccountable this particular decision was made, and indeed the accountability measures afterwards. And so again, Councillor Singh, thank you very much for bringing your motion forward to look into this a little bit more deeply. I think $1.5 million is a lot of money, and it is a sad day to then look back and see how poorly that money was invested. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Santos. Councillor Williams.
Thank you.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Councillor Singh is next on the board.
Oh, okay.
I thought on the, it says at 10:23, Councillor Santos, and then I was right after her.
Yeah, on my list, that's what it says as well.
No, I sent it privately by
okay.
Peter sees it and nobody else sees it.
No problem, I'll yield.
Sorry, thanks. Thank you, Councillor Williams. I'll be brief. A lot of my questions have been asked. I do to elaborate on Derek, Director of Voices, comments. The what prompted me to bring this motion was actually reading the prior reports, and staff was not supportive of this. And they had some reservations. I remember particularly, if my memory serves me correctly, around audited financial statements as well. So that was the reason for asking the report, for the report. And obviously there's a lot of learning that is going to come out of this, and hopefully we can make stronger policies, especially around monitoring sort of our agreements and the success of those agreements. There is no other way to say this, but obviously it is brutal. I look at in the appendices, you know, the city invested $1.5 million and potentially, so we're not even sure, obtained $580,500 in benefits. So obviously we want to make sure something like that doesn't occur again. And I do have one question, and that is regarding this motion was passed on the first council meeting, and my question actually first goes to MNP. When did you finish this report?
So the report was completed September 2019, I believe.
Yeah.
And this was, at that time, it was issued in draft. We were waiting for a direction from city staff in terms of steps, and had not heard back until we'd reached out a few times to the commissioner at the time, and had not heard back in terms of next steps. Until recently, when Derek reached out to us and said that it was back on the table.
Yeah, and that's because I know Derek, along with their CEO, really looked into it in the last couple of weeks. So some learning there. I know we had some changes, so it's we don't know where the accountability lies, but you know, moving forward, trying to get these reports to council as soon as we can, so that it informs our future decision making for the best possible outcomes for our residents. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you to MNP. Thank you to Mr. Boyce, and thank you to our CAO.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Singh. Councillor Williams, second time a charm.
Thank you, through you, Mayor. Yes, thank you for MMP for doing this report, and Councillor Singh, thanks for bringing this forward and in the first place. I think we, you know, if we had this earlier, we would have been able to, you know, help kind of bring it to the forefront of how important it is for accountability and to make sure that we are, you know, tracking where the money is going and how it's being spent, and for everything that we do, especially for large sums of money. I know sometimes, you know, people, it's hard to wrap your head around giving $1 million because it's such a large sum of money, or 1.5 million. But when it's smaller amounts, like 30,000, it's relatable. But large sums of money is so important to make sure we're tracking, because it impacts many different people on different levels. So I'm just, you know, to not have ROIs or KPIs on this, to me, is really shocking. And it's something I know I've talked about, making sure we have a framework in place to kind of track where these monies are going. So with regards to economic development, I know we have a framework in place, but can somebody speak to that framework to make sure we are reassuring our taxpayers and residents that we are not going to be making the same mistake for going forward? So can we have some kind of outline just to highlight what we're doing now to ensure that these types of monies are being tracked for sponsorships and such?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, this is Derek again. I'm not sure if sponsorship staff is on the line, but I'll attempt to answer your question, Councillor Williams. So as a credit to staff, in the interim since this agreement was put in place, previous staff did implement a sponsorship team. And so there is a sponsorship team now in place under the leadership of, it's in Richard Ford's area right now, but Tara Hunter and Michael Miel. And so they bring a wealth of experience in sponsorship and advertising. And they, as council is aware, they've been out doing some of the naming and advertising agreements. And so that is part of the scrutiny that's in place right now, is that they do valuations in advance of agreements. They take a look at analysis, steam analysis. I know also in the tourism and sports tourism area, they do the same type of thing in terms of looking at what the impact is to Brampton residents. So although this report is not favorable right now, there are a lot of measures that staff have put in place in the interim to ensure that there are some controls into what you speak about, some scrutiny in terms of these deals. And we have the staff expertise now in-house to be able to really ensure that the city gets the appropriate value from these deals.
Thank you, through the mayor. That is good to hear that we as a council now have really actively pushed to make sure that we are doing this type of ROI. And so to rest assured taxpayers that we are making sure that your money is going to the right places when we are investing these large sums of money like this. So I'm just curious to know, even though it was not encouraged by staff in the report, at the time, I don't know if anybody can answer this because, you know, many of people aren't here, but why not put some kind of ask in that motion to amend? We amend motions all the time here to say that we are going to have this tracked. It makes me scratch my head because, you know, this is the beasts are, it's fun going to the games, but it isn't pulling the amount of people that it was hoping to pull. So I just think we lesson learned, definitely lesson learned. And thank you Derek for bringing this back up, doing that background research to help us understand where we need to make some changes to make sure this doesn't happen again. Thank you.
Yes, the next up is Councillor Vicente.
Thank you, Mayor Brown, and thank you to all the comments from the previous speakers here on this. I'd just like to add some personal perspective from my own point of view. In 2017, or I think it was in late 16 or 2017 when this was being debated at council, I remember posting on my social media page with regards to this decision as it was pending at Brampton City Council, just to get input from people who follow me on social media. And I was absolutely overwhelmed by responses from members of the community, really opposed to the idea that a municipality which has a precious charge of making sure that we administer resources to really what our priorities in the community. And folks were adamant that the city of Brampton should not be supporting a hockey team, a for-profit hockey team, mind you. You know, this is a hockey team that is owned by a significant business interest in the province. And for us to have to come to their rescue, as one councillor said, you know, to privatize the profits, but nationalize the losses. It was really, I think, a decision that staff warned against and advised that it really wasn't the purview of the city to be involved in such things. And it's always the case. I remember when I was a kid watching the debates happening in Toronto and Ontario at the time when the Toronto Maple Leafs were in trouble. And they were looking for funding from the provincial and federal governments at the time. And then, as it was now, that people, the taxpayers, were vehemently opposed to the support of for-profit organizations by taxpayer dollars. And so I think that this is something that we could have seen coming. And it was easy just from the perspective, not from numbers and cents, but from sentiment from the public, that this was an area that the city should not have gone into. And, you know, kudos to staff at the time for crunching the numbers and for providing that kind of forward-looking glimpse on how this might have turned out. And so I think that I want to just underline something that Councillor Madero said, and that it's very important that staff continue to be resilient and offer us here at Brampton Council with the best advice, the best technical data, and best practices from other municipalities so that we can make the best decisions possible on behalf of the residents here of the city. It's a shame to see that $1.5 million went to this when it could have so much better served community groups here in the city who, as members have expressed, we sometimes spend a great deal of time debating whether or not we should give $10,000 or $50,000 or $150,000 here and there for what we have identified are priorities for the residents of this city, and in, as opposed to something which clearly we could have seen in both with foresight and now in hindsight, that this was really a decision that was not in the best interest of the city. You know, and so I just want to just go back to staff and ask them, as you continue to do work on behalf of all residents and to inform us, please make sure that you continue to do that good work and bring us the facts that we need to make good decisions. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Vicente, and I have to agree, you know, this is something that we should have been able to see coming. The reality is an ECHL team is not an OHL team. It's not an AHL team. Very few people from the ECHL end up playing professional, and so it's a harder ticket. If we're depending on revenue sources that are going to be based on fan participation, you just look at any ECHL team around the league, it's not the same as the OHL or AHL market. So, you know, at the end of the day, hindsight's 20/20, and we can't go back in time, but let's just make sure that this informs us on future decisions. Next up on my list, I have Harkirat, but he's already spoken, so I assume that takes us down to Councillor Pelletier. Peter, is that correct?
That is correct, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you to members of council. Not sure what report everybody's looking at. It's funny that councillors can just throw words at a report to make it seem worse than it really is. The report that I'm looking at clearly states that the City of Brampton had no backstop independent city data to verify the advertising is being put forward. So very an inconclusive report. And I guess if members want to say that, you know, it was a bad idea to invest in the Beast from the beginning, I guess it was a bad idea to invest in this consultant's report, because basically it tells us very nothing. Mr. Mayor, you had mentioned that ECHL compared to the OHL, and just with, you know, some high level numbers here, the ECHL Brampton Beast did a lot better in ticket sales than the OHL ever did in the City of Brampton. 700,000 just in the 7 years that they were here. We had a presence in many U.S. cities like Atlanta, Kansas City, Cincinnati, Orlando. We've received almost 100 corporate partners contacts through the Brampton Beast. 16,000 kids per year go to the Brampton Beast and enjoy school days and the minor hockey associations that are affiliated with the city. So huge not-for-profit investments that went into with the Brampton Beast, and so I guess it's funny that we sit here and say that there was the first report did indicate that from staff that not to go through with this, much like the first report from staff on Neighborhood Watch Brampton. This was this won't be the first time that we did something like this. We thought it was a good idea at the time, and I still think it was a good idea. There's many other municipalities that invest in their either hockey teams, sporting clubs, and affiliates, and I encourage all members to continue to advocate for any groups that are in the city to bring a smile on a kid's face or anybody's face. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, and Councillor Plushy, what I was referring to is I've gone to a number of ECHL games and I haven't noticed participation there. I've been to OHL games locally, like the Steelheads, and there's a different level of participation. And I used to tour rinks across Ontario, and so I've got a good sense of where there's an average crowd and where there isn't. And it's just, and maybe the times I've gone has been different, but I certainly haven't seen it in Brampton. You know, I saw the way you look at the GT20 where there was, you know, 10,000 people there. It's a very different atmosphere and a very different marketing opportunity. But like I said, hindsight's 20/20. I don't see it with this one, but we're all entitled to our perspectives. Councillor Bowman.
Thank you very much, through you, Mr. Mayor. Again, just a couple of questions for
MNP because I read the report. And from what I can see from the report is saying that the ability to measure the impact that this money had is not available to you. Is that correct?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Yes, that is a correct statement. What I would say, and going back to the earlier comment about the report being inconclusive, I really do want to emphasize that point where the conclusion around it being inconclusive really relates to the fact that data did not exist. The right level of measurement and results was not in place or being tracked by the city for us to really make a conclusion. So it's hard to say where the value was derived or achieved looking back when there wasn't that information available to us to make it. So what I would urge you to do in terms of looking at this report and looking at the value coming out of this report itself, I wouldn't say necessarily around the conclusion, but the lessons learned and some of the things that could have been done differently in terms of not investing the money, but in terms of how to invest the money and the sponsorship dollars to maybe get better results. One example I would draw your attention to is the observation number 3 around performing analysis in terms of alternative methods of spending the money. So instead of, as Deepak said earlier, putting the Brampton City logo on a Brampton Beast van that only gets seen when they're going to and from games, there were avenues where I think there was a comment mentioned about coverage and that there's a lot of coverage and receptiveness to the Brampton Beast in down south in the United States. So when we did some high-level assessments ourselves, we found, you know, 4 key cities, Orlando, Phoenix, Boston, LA, where you could have gotten monthly billboard costs at much less dollars, and it has much broader coverage in terms of population. So that was one of the key measurement points that was missing as well in terms of there was no market analysis performed in terms of how the 1.5 should be spent. So I think if you look closely at the report itself, there's key facts or elements that can be extrapolated from that could be applied going forward as a lessons learned exercise versus just focusing on the comment being that it's inconclusive. Because I think there's a lot of information in there that can be garnered that can make it, I guess, more robust and comprehensive going forward in terms of a management program.
Okay.
Hope that answers the question.
Yeah, thanks for that. And when you say there was better value than the $500,000 per year in all those other markets, are you talking about being cheaper than $500,000? So you're just looking at the one cost of the $500,000?
What we intended to do is we looked at key elements of the agreement ourselves to say what tangible I guess benefits were being garnered from the city in terms of tickets being provided that could be shared across the city for attendance at games, billboard placements, marketing advertisements, web-based branding. We looked at, well, what are some of the tangible things coming out of the agreement that money was actually spent on within the agreement? But what we were not able to find were some of the indirect things like additional revenues being generated by the city, additional tourism, additional ticket sales or seating, because that data just was not being collected. And so you can't go back later and then hope to find that data because it just didn't exist anymore. So the $580,000 were the tangible items that we were able to get our hands or a handle around in terms of what would be the market value appended to that. Jason, I know one of the key parts that you had done with respect to the engagement was around the ROI piece. Any other context you can share there?
Yes, I'll say first off that the, I guess a repeat to say we're inconclusive in terms of whether or not the benefits were, when all those sort of additional benefits like hotel stays and additional expenditures of visitors, municipal taxes, those kinds of things. There was a proposal that's what would happen, and quite frankly, it might have happened. There might have been hotel stays. There might have been visitors, spending in restaurants, but we don't know. What we do know is that the attendance numbers were lower than projected. So any kind of spin-off benefits would likely be lower than what were projected. But the basic problem is that we don't have the data to be able to conclude what that ROI is. We were able to quantify some of it, the $580,000and $500. We were able to quantify that, but the rest of it, there was just not the data to support it. The other thing I would say is, with respect to Jeff's example about, you know, a billboard, I think our point there was that if you make a decision as council to say, we want to spend $1.5 million on a sponsorship, we want to improve our brand image internationally, we want to put, the expression was great, we want to put smiles on kids' faces, what's the best way of spending the $1.5 million would be a question to ask, and rather than looking at one proposal and saying, okay, here's what we're going to get from this. The example was that if you do want to increase your exposure in those international markets, you can get very, very high exposure just with some cool-looking brand billboards. So the question is, if you're going to spend that much money on sponsorships and on building brand and on community spirit-type events and sports, what's the best way of getting a return on that $1.5 million as opposed to simply looking at just one agreement and not thinking about, well, how best could we spend this money elsewhere?
Yeah, and I agree with that, Jason. When someone brings a STEAM study for anything, and the Brampton Beast, if I remember, did bring a STEAM study that indicated about, I think it was roughly $3 million a year in spin-off benefits. When those are presented, are those fully tangible? Do those numbers always come true?
Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But you certainly need the measurement process to see, particularly things that are measurable, like hotel stays, like number of visitors. Those are things that you can track, and so. You. There might have been some benefits. There's probably some hotel stays, but we don't have the data to be able to say how much of a benefit was that, to quantify it.
Right, and I believe, I'm not 100% certain, but I think they played 30-some-odd home games here. So, you know, those numbers would be easy to add up. What about the intangible benefits that were provided to the city of the Brampton Beast because they were here, attending all sorts of charitable activities for a very large number of charitable organizations, raising money for them, also employing, I don't know the exact number, but several adults with special needs. How do we quantify intangible benefits of things like that?
That's an excellent question. And what we typically will do is we will go as far as we can in terms of quantifying things. So, for example, in the community outreach, we could measure number of events and number of people at events, number of free tickets that were given away, number of community groups that were supported. So we can quantify some of those things, but then we would also probably say that there is additional non-quantifiable benefits to do with goodwill, brand image, you know, a positive wellness of folks that have the experiences. So we try as best we can to quantify those things that are more intangible, but we also recognize that some things are just fundamentally unquantifiable, and we just list them out at what those things might be.
Sure.
And
sure.
And I would say, in terms of those unquantifiable things, there's also measurement tools that are available to you that we've applied ourselves, like external surveys that can be conducted. So there could be a survey sent out to the city itself, constituents, saying, what is the market penetration? What is the brand awareness being generated? What is your overall sense of the value that you're seeing coming out of it? So those are the things that can't be quantified. You can also get some qualitative information from conducting things like surveys and outreach programs.
Okay, thanks very much.
I believe Councilor Santos would like to speak next.
Thank you. For the second time, just a couple of follow-up questions. The Brampton Beast sponsorship agreement, just for clarification, they are a for-profit organization. Is that correct?
Through the mayor to Councillor Santos, I do believe, yes, they are for profit. Trying to read former reports, but I do believe they are, yes.
Okay, and so when we're comparing community group organizations, whether they be Neighborhood Watch Brampton, which was referenced, which was supposed to deal with safety issues related to a Brampton priority on safety, which, by the way, we did not approve the further funding of that organization based on their performance, but that was 10 times less than $1.5 million for a for-profit organization. My other question, just for comparison purposes, is in relation to a similar situation that we had just last year regarding the GT20, where we had a big cricket tournament happen in the city of Brampton. I believe the city of Brampton also provided a level of sponsorship. I don't think it was $1.5 million, but I certainly believe it was a lot less. And maybe staff can clarify from the sponsorship team how much we spent. But for the record, I do remember attending a few of those games, and the stands were completely packed. And Mr. Mayor, maybe you can confirm, because I know that you had the numbers and we had an event in City Hall, about the number of eyeballs from around the world who were watching the cricket tournament. That tournament happened in a period of 2 weeks or something like that. We spent significantly less, and we might have received far more eyeballs and on the city of Brampton than I would guess, you know, anecdotally, the Brampton Beast has generated over the years of this particular agreement. So staff, have any comments to clarify those numbers? And Mr. Mayor, the numbers of how many eyeballs the successful GT20 tournament gave the city of Brampton, that would be great.
Could we have Derek Boyce, if he's on the line, could speak to this, answer your question, and I'll see if I can get the stat for you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Through you, Mr. Mayor, to Councillor Santos. I don't have the number off the top of my head. I believe Tara Hunter might be on the line, and I don't know if she does. If not, we can definitely research that and get it back to you. I don't know if Tara's on the line, if she knows. Okay.
Hi, through you, Mr. Mayor. Tara Hunter is here. Hi, everyone. We will get back to you and confirm that number.
Thank you.
Councilor Santos, remember, part of the challenge with the GT20 wasn't necessarily the need for sponsorship, but was trying to deal with the fact that we had a third-party operator that was in charge of the lands at the time, and they had increased the rent from $50,000 to $500,000 because they thought this was a potential revenue stream for them. It was 133 million people that watched worldwide. I just got that, pulled that up, 133 million. So it is a different a dynamic, and we got commercials played to that wide audience. Listen, I'm a hockey guy. I love hockey. I actually watch minor hockey and take an interest in all these leagues. But, you know, I'm being pessimistic today, but I just didn't see the value for taxpayers. And normally I try to I'm a glass half full type of perspective. But, you know, I just think we need to learn from this. It didn't meet our expectations, and I'm glad we've had a fulsome discussion on this, and we can learn from we can learn from everything. I know Councillor Singh wanted to move the report. I don't see anyone else on the speakers list. Is there someone that wishes to second it?
Second it, Councillor Dillon.
Okay. And Councillor Vicente too. Okay, so seconded by Councillor Vicente and Dillon.
Oh, I'd like to second that as well, Councillor Mayor Brown.
Okay, also seconded by Councillor Medeiros. Are there any objections?
Mayor Brown, I'll second that too, please.
Okay, Councillor Fortini also seconded it.
So, Mr. Mayor, just to clarify, the first motion is just to receive the presentation from MMP, and then the second motion, for which I believe a number of members wish to second, is to receive the actual staff report, 10.5.2. Is that correct?
Sure. Okay, so just to receive the presentation, anyone opposed? Motion carries, and then I believe now it's to accept the staff report, and I believe now Councillor Williams wants a second as well. So moved by Councillor Singh, seconded by Councillors Vicente Medeiros, Fortini, Williams, Santos.
Mr. Mayor, I'm happy to second it as well.
Councillor Pelleschi as well. Okay.
Yep, and no problem. The report is fine.
Okay, seconded by all councillors. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. This takes us to our next item, which Peter's pulling up on the screen. Reports. This is my report now. COVID-19 emergency update. I gave this update earlier today, just highlighting that I was disappointed, and we sort of talked about this earlier in the government relations section, how I was disappointed with the closure of restaurants and recreation in Peel Region. We had asked for the closure of banquet halls, but you know, this is a little bit more than we were asking for. I've communicated that to the Premier. I would note that I'm working with the hospital leadership and public health to share our data with the province, so they've got a better sense of how the picture is different in Peel Region than it is in Toronto. And I'd also highlight that we still have contact tracing in Peel Region. We're about a day delayed, 24 hours delayed, but we still have contact tracing. They don't have that in Toronto. So we're in Toronto, they don't necessarily know where the virus is. We do in Peel Region still. And Peel Public Health has beefed up to added additional bodies to help achieve this. I'm not sure how much longer they're going to be able to maintain contact tracing as they fall further behind, as there's more cases. It's tough to maintain it, but as it stands today, we still have contact tracing. Hospitalization is up a little bit. We're at 14 inpatients at Brampton Civic and 2 in ICU. So that's doubled at Osler Health in the last week. So it's something to be aware of, that we're seeing an uptick in hospitalization. Those were the big changes in the last week. We were sort of taken by surprise by the modified stage 2. And my heart goes out to our small businesses, our restaurants. This is going to be tough. In the spring, you know, they had the benefit of good weather. It got warmer every day, and patios, you know, they could make a success. And, you know, we try to build momentum around takeout. Doing this all again, it's like running a marathon and saying that you got to run another 10K. And so the next 28 days, I'm asking council, everyone, get your friends, get your family, get your neighbors to support a local business. And at least the restaurants are getting some financial support for hydro and property taxes. For like dance studios, private recreation, that doesn't exist. You know, I gave the example to Charmaine earlier that, you know, Jade's Dance Academy, they have a rent of $11,000 a month. You know, I don't want to see these businesses go under. And so, Mayor Crombie and myself expressed our frustration to the province about this, because it wasn't consistent with the data we were seeing, and all the other decisions that we've made so far during this pandemic have been data driven. And this wasn't data driven. I've also continued to highlight, in my media and in my interviews, that you have to look at where we have a greater risk in Brampton and where we're getting transmission. It's not parties anymore. We only had one ticket this weekend. It really is our unsung essential workers. You know, you look at the transmission, 11,000 people working in the transportation logistics sector. We have truckers getting COVID-19. We've had outbreaks in the food processing sector. 8,000 500 people working in our food processing sector. These people are heroes. They're going into an environment that is at a greater risk, not to mention our healthcare workers or people working in medical technology and medical laboratories. We have unsung essential heroes who are doing a great service, not just to Brampton, but to Canada. If our essential workers were not working each day, Canada's supply chain would be completely damaged. You want grocery in your shelves? Whether you want groceries in your shelves in Kingston or whether you want a supply chain maintained in Timmins, you need Brampton working. You need Brampton's essential workers working. I read a stat that Amazon in Brampton is responsible for 80% of the logistics in our province. Incredible. So let's be grateful for how Brampton is rising to the occasion and playing a bigger role in this pandemic, and the country's relying on them. But let's also not penalize those that frankly are not facing the same dynamic. Our restaurants, our recreation are not facing the same dynamic. And so I'm going to continue my advocacy to the province and appreciate efforts that councillors do as well. We have some questions now. Councillor Williams.
Hi, yes, thank you, Mayor. Just a question about the testing. I know there were some residents that were concerned about waiting longer than 5 days to receive the results of their testing. So I'm wondering if you had any background information to share with our residents about how we are doing and if we're getting up to date, and if we are going to be receiving some information about a testing mechanism or machine in our hospitals. I believe Dr. Muhammad was mentioning something about that. So I'm just wondering if you had any information to update. Thanks.
Yeah, good question. And you probably recall I was advocating for the ability to process tests locally. There is a massive provincial backlog that's been a part of a lot of media scrutiny. And so one of the reasons that I wanted local processing is that we're not part of that provincial backlog. Right previously, before we started our advocacy, we were only allowed to process 100 tests a day. So imagine if you're testing 1,000 people a day, then all of us are 700, 800 a day, and then you're only allowed to process 100. It means the vast majority of our tests got put into this provincial backlog. As of October 16th, we'll be allowed to process 800 a day, which is up from 100. And then once the new equipment arrives, we will be able to process 1,600 a day. So that's in the right direction. So October 14th today. We're only 2 days away from having that processing. And that's something that I had personally pleaded to the Premier about, with Dr. Naveed Muhammad supporting our request. And so test results, we're about to get a lot faster once we have that local testing. Local testing means you get it back in about a day or two, where provincial testing could be, it could be four times that.
Great, thank you.
Councillor Medeiros.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, I just want to recognize your advocacy and leadership. I think especially recently really raising those issues and really stepping up to the plate for our small businesses. I've seen businesses in Ward 3 and 4, be it bars and restaurants, officially closed down. And I was contacted by a resident today who owns a gym. And his question was around, gyms are closed and the province made that decision. However, for example, there's sports training going on. And, and that sort of raises the question about the consistency and application of, for example, a bylaw officer, one of our officers who maybe gets a complaint, goes into, for example, a gym. If they're doing sports training or they're doing gymnastics in what was the gym, how is that deemed? And I'm not, I wouldn't expect you would have an answer. But, and I don't know if anyone, if staff can sort of answer that, but are there opportunities for some of these organizations, or be it gyms or businesses, to sort of branch out into different areas which where they're allowed to, that doesn't require, So I guess what I'm saying is, a business who's running a gym and wants to transform into specialized sports training,
you know, be it in one certain sport, is it something that is easily done, or is that, you know, all that sort of, and I wonder if restaurants too, I guess, takeout seems to be their only option. So I guess they wouldn't have that option as much, but I'm just looking, trying to be creative on how we can help some of these businesses tap into, you know, being able to use some of their operations to adapt it to sort of the circumstances. Because you're right, like everyone's on the cusp of, you know, closing down, and people are dealing with severe debt. And, you know, so it's just, and I don't know if there's a question there, and staff can speak to me offline, but it just seems we're helpless right now in supporting these businesses.
I'm going to ask if Paul Morrison can, if he's on the line, if he can speak to this, our director of bylaw, in terms of any discretion for a different use. I know that question was asked today, you know, could a dance academy act as a day camp, which is permitted? Paul, if you could speak to the provincial regulations, I believe they're being amended today. So it is confusing because the province has had some errors in their initial regulations. So Paul, maybe if you want to share with council what you shared with me earlier today.
Mayor, it's David here. Paul is not on the line currently. What we can do though is request him to do a memo to council, put the information you've requested.
Okay. Councillor Medeiros, we do have to follow the provincial regulations, but I think you're on to something about how, you know, it's just, we got to be creative, because I really, really worry that we're going to see businesses go under. This is tough.
Yeah. Thank you, Mayor Brown, again. And thank you for the challenge, you know, to get people to support their local restaurants by doing takeout during this month. Thank you.
And I would encourage all members of council, just, you know, share on social media, tell the story. You know, what really hurt me the other day is I went to RD's barbecue, and I posted a photo and highlighted how it was Jean there, who I believe is a Ward 2 and 6 resident, Councillor Pelleschi and Willens. I said how he did an amazing job with his barbecue. And then we got a few messages afterwards from people telling me they went out and they enjoyed it as well, and they thought he did a great job. And so it shows you one of the powers we have. We have a platform as elected officials to share stories, and it can help. It can create a positive benefit for some of these restaurants. And so people follow all your social media accounts, and Councilor Medeiros, if you're going to pick up dinner for your wife, like I know you do, well, then go on social media and share that restaurant that you picked up the dinner for. And likewise to all councillors, let's look at ways that we can share to the city some of the hidden restaurants we have. And a reason I reference Jean's shop is because it is a little bit hidden, and so there's a lot of restaurants that people can learn about for the first time. So thank you for that question, Councillor Medeiros, and now Councillor Pelleschi.
No, and thank you. A great question, Councillor Medeiros. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just building off of that, Mr. Mayor, you know that in the beginning, and still today, to this day, that we have a number of Brampton organizations that are donating to either the hospital, to our food banks, to our frontline workers, and to all members of council. I know we've all been on the side of being criticized for going out there and snapping a picture with these businesses on the donation, but I've had it done a few times, and I personally want to thank all and every member of council for doing that, because it's a small token of a thank you to these organizations. The only thing that they ask in return is for us to come out and be a part of the donation. And if we can continue to do that, Mr. Mayor, I know you've been busy doing a number of those, and a lot of other members of council, Councillor Santos, Councillor Vincente, and all members have been out there you know, thanking these organizations with that small token of respect, and I just ask that you keep doing that, and you're doing a great job with doing stuff like that. So thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, members of council.
And I believe Paul Morrison is on the line now, if he wants to add some clarification into
the interpretation of the provincial regulations.
I'm sorry, Mr. Mayor, my interpretation for the regulations for which exactly? I lost so, audio.
Council Medeiros was asking if there are a gym or a restaurant that wants to operate as a different use. Do they have the ability to adapt their uses? A gym that may want to act as a day camp or a restaurant that may want to change their use. I think it's more of a creative question. Council Medeiros was asking, given the adversity that some of these small businesses are going through, and I know you are very strict in interpreting the provincial regulations, and so what advice you could offer to that question?
So we were looking at the regulations, and there are some pieces in there talk about that if facilities being used, that the equipment for what its original purpose, such as a gym, is, has to be put aside and rendered non-usable in the sense that covered, etc. That so if somebody wants to convert a space, I would think that would be an opportunity to be creative and move forward and conduct business as long as the activity is not a prohibited activity. So you can't turn a gym into a dance studio because dancing is not allowed. But if you turned it into something else that doesn't fall under the prohibited activities, then why wouldn't you want to? So I guess the hard part is if you give me a specific example, I might be able to answer because there's so many variables here.
Okay, and Paul, I'm sure if a gym or a restaurant had a question, they could call bylaw directly, ask for Paul Morrison, and I know there's been cases where you have spoken directly to business owners to answer their questions. We know this is a difficult period, and we will do our best to help you interpret what is allowed under the provincial regulations during this 28-day period, and let's just hope it doesn't extend beyond 28 days.
Absolutely. Happy to take any questions.
Okay. So this covers our COVID update. I don't see any other questions. I have a motion moved by Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Medeiros, that the update for the COVID-19 emergency to Council be received. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. This takes us to our next item. Peter will put up on the screen.
Mr. Mayor, just to advise, item 10.3.1 would be the first report under corporate officials, but that item's been withdrawn from the agenda to be presented to a future meeting. We have item 10.5.1. That item was approved as part of the consent motion. So now we can go on to item 12, which are committee reports.
Okay, the Planning and Development Committee met on October 5th. The committee minutes are here for Council's consideration and approval. I'll now pass the chair to Council Medeiros to lead Council in consideration of the committee minutes.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of Council, you have before you the minutes of the Planning and Development Committee from October 5th. Are there any questions or comments? No? Okay, back to you, Mayor.
Okay, thank you, Council Medeiros. I have a motion moved by Councillor Medeiros, seconded by Councillor Fratini to approve the committee minutes. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will count in the affirmative. Hearing none, the motion carries. Our next set of minutes is item 12.2. The Committee of Council met on October 7th. The committee minutes are here for Council's consideration and approval. I'll now pass the chair to the respective section chairs in order of consideration during the committee meeting to lead Council consideration and the committee recommendations. Councillor Vicente chaired the Economic Development and Culture section. He also chaired the Public Works and Engineering section. Councillor Singh chaired the Corporate Services section. Councillor Santos chaired the Community Services section. Council will then consider a motion to approve the recommendations in its entirety after all section chairs have concluded their summaries and any resulting questions debate has finished. Councillor Vicente.
Mr. Mayor, members of Council, you have the minutes of the meeting of Committee of Council. Do any of you have any questions with regards to the Economic Development and Culture or the Public Works and Engineering sections? I see none. Mayor, back to you.
Councillor Singh.
Hi, you have the, hello to my colleagues. You have the minutes in front of you for the corporate services section. Do any members have any questions? Hearing and seeing none, I pass it on to, back to you, Mayor.
Councillor Santos.
Thank you through you, Mr. Mayor. Members of Council, you have the minutes regarding the community services section. Do any members have any questions? I see none on the board. Over to you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. I have a motion moved by Councillor Santos, seconded by Councillor Singh to approve the committee minutes. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. This takes us to item 13, a motion introduced by Councillor Medeiros at last week's Committee of Council regarding the provision, a letter of credit to the Peel Islamic Cultural Center and a request for staff to report to today's council meeting. Further information related to this item will be considered under added item 19.5. And so, Peter, will we deal with this at item 19.5 or we deal with it now?
Through you, Mr. Chair, I would advise we would deal with it with the balance of the closed session business, and then if there is anything to report publicly, okay, we'll report out after.
Okay, sounds good. This takes us to item 14. This is a request from the Fiji Multicultural Society of Ontario dated October 6. The request was to name a street in honour of Fiji's 50th independence anniversary. I would note I have gone to a number of Fiji Canadian community galas in Brampton. It is a small but dynamic and vibrant community. They were asking for a small street, a court, to be considered. And so I just suggest we refer this to the street naming committee to look into. And I see Councillor Vicente has agreed to second this and that they should be part of Carabram as well. Okay, Councillor Dillon, you have a question, you want to speak to this?
Oh, yes. So I actually just wanted to ask, who's moving this, yourself?
Sure, I'll move it and second it by Councillor Vicente.
Right. I was on the board before Councillor Vicente. I wanted to second it, actually.
Okay, sure. We can have you second it as well. And so, Peter, just procedurally referring this to the Street Naming Committee?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, that's correct. And then subject to approval by the Peel Street Naming Committee, it'll come back to Council for approval in addition to the names list.
Okay. And so can we have, I see Councillor Singh also asked to second it as well. So we can have three seconders. Look, there's a lot of love for Fiji today. And Councillor Vicente has requested a recorded vote. He wants anyone who doesn't love Fiji to have to vote publicly against Fiji.
So members of council, recorded vote has been requested on the motion as shown on the screen. The referral, all in favor, please indicate. Councillor Dillon.
In favor.
Councillor Singh.
In favor.
Councillor Fortini.
In favor.
Councillor Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros.
Yes.
Councillor Bowman.
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Yes.
Councillor Willens.
Sure.
Councillor Vicente.
Yes.
Councillor Santos.
Yes.
Mayor Brown.
Yes, and I'm more emphatic than Councillor Willens, sure.
So that motion carries unanimously 11 to 0.
Okay, this takes us to our next item, which is item 16.1, referred matters list. This list is published quarterly on a media agenda, and a copy is linked with each agenda to include a current listing of matters referred to city staff for further review and report back to Councillor General Committee. Do any members have any questions? Please use the chat function. I don't see any, so we will move on to the next item, which is item 16.2, which is discussion at the request of Councillor Dillon in regards to, and I wasn't here when this was added, if you can see the title of the item.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's the Indian farming protests in Brampton from Councillor Dillon.
Okay, Councillor Dillon, if you'd like to speak to this.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I'm not sure if council is aware, there's been a number of peaceful protests that have taken that have been taking place across Brampton. There was one on Monday that had about 500 cars. It was a car rally. There's been a number of similar types of car rallies that have taken place, and all have been following the COVID-19 guidelines. The police were made aware of these protests as well, and they assisted in trying to ensure they went as smoothly as possible. So I want to thank them. And so essentially what it is that there's, I would say, tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of people of South Asian descent, Indian descent in particular, who are still connected back home by their farmland, just like a number of other communities still are. I know there's Councillor Spoveri still had farmland back home. I remember him telling me. There's a number of different communities that are still connected, as I mentioned. And so these protests, essentially what they are, are against some new bills that have taken place that have passed recently in India. And in no way this is a this motion that I'm bringing forward is political in nature. It's just simply supporting the residents that are affected by it and their families that are affected by it as well. And so the current economic situation of farmers back in India is in a dire straits right now. It's a dire situation. And I'll read the preamble, and I'll read the recommendation to therefore after as well. If there's any questions, some you can ask, definitely ask. So it's moved by myself and seconded by Councillor Medeiros, whereas the City of Brampton remains a proud farming community. Whereas the City of Brampton understands and respects the contributions of farmers in feeding nations, whereas the City of Brampton is home to thousands of farmers who still own farmland in their ancestral countries, whereas numerous rallies have taken place across the City of Brampton protesting three farming bills that were passed in India in September 2020, whereas the passing of the bills will result in the privatization of farmers' markets in India and adversely affect the financial situation of many Bramptonians and their families back home, whereas India's agricultural sector contributes nearly 15% of India's $2.9 trillion economy, but employs nearly half of the country's 1.3 billion people, whereas 86% of farmers only own two or less acres of farmland with an average income of $1,400 per year and do not have the means to bargain with large private organizations, whereas anti-farmer policies, debt, and deteriorating financial status have led to 363,726 farmers and farm laborers committing suicide between 1995 and 2019, whereas Brampton City Council has recognized and stood with its Black, Tamil, Vietnamese, and other communities whose families have faced hardship abroad. Therefore, be it resolved that the City of Brampton stand in solidarity with those Brampton residents and their families who have been directly affected by the farming bills passed in India. And so I think the key takeaway here is you have about 24 years, you have 363,000 people killing themselves in India. And those are direct relatives of the, 40% of Brampton's population, which is South Asian. And so I think it's really important to recognize the pain that a lot of the residents are going through right now. My parents still own farmland back home. I know Councillor Singh's, families has a farming background. I know, a lot of different councillors, even on regional council, still own farmland. So I'm sure they can empathize with what's going on. And so, there's always pros and cons to every decision made. Some people are arguing that it's a good bill, but a lot of people in Brampton right now feel like they'll be going through more and more hardship. As I mentioned, farmer suicide is something that's prevalent and it's increasing year by year. And we want to make sure that we stand with our families who are affected directly in Brampton.
Councilor Medeiros?
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Councilor Dillon, for bringing this forward. And in fact, it's interesting when I, in terms of some of my residents and especially some of the senior clubs, for over the, since I've been elected, I never quietly understood why a lot of people, there'd be this mass exodus to go back home to India, especially from our seniors population. And a lot of them would tell me stories of how they own land and they own farms and so on and so on. So they would go off. And I think many of us know residents who sort of go back to India for 3-4 months at the time. And I thought it was just to escape our brutal winters. But no, in fact, was to deal with some of these issues. And in fact, just doing, you know, following Councillor Dillon's briefing me on this and educating me to some of these issues, I, you know, just going right on, you know, the internet and see, speaking out to some of my sort of residents, I didn't realize how a large issue this is in the community. So I just want to send my full support and thank you, Councillor Dillon, for raising this issue.
I don't see any other questions. So the motion's on the floor, moved by Councillor Dillon, seconded by Councillor Medeiros.
I'd like to second to Councillor.
Okay. Are there any objections?
Could we get a recorded vote, Mayor Brown?
Okay.
A recorded vote's been requested on item 16.2, the motion by Councillor Dillon. All those in favor, please indicate. Councillor Dillon?
In favor.
Councillor Singh?
Favor.
Councillor Fortini?
Absolutely in favor.
Councillor Williams?
Yes, in favor.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Bowman? I believe Councillor Bowman had to leave for other municipal business, so he's absent. Councillor Pelleschi?
Yes.
Councillor Willens?
Sure.
Councillor Visante?
Yes.
Councillor Santos?
Yes.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor, that motion carries unanimously 10-0 with one absence.
Okay, this takes us to item 17, public question period. There are no other item items, Peter?
There are not, Mr. Mayor.
Public question period. This is normally where we invite members of the public to come forward and ask any questions, but a decision made by council at today's meeting. There's a 15-minute limit. I'll ask the clerk if any questions are submitted to him during today's meeting.
There are no questions, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. This takes us to bylaws. We're now at the portion of the meeting dealing with the adoption of city bylaws to give effect to the council decisions made at this meeting. I have a motion moved by Councillor Vicente, seconded by Councillor Willens to approve the bylaws. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will count in the affirmative. Hearing none, the motion carries. Our next item of business is closed session. I have a motion by Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Fortini to move into closed session to deal with the following items. Minutes closed session September 30th, minutes closed session October 7th, open session meeting exemption under section 239E and F of the Municipal Act, which is a litigation, potential litigation matter. 19.4 open session meeting exception under 2.39 as well. 19.5 open session meeting exception under 2.39K.
And Mr. Mayor, just to advise that, sorry, Mr. Mayor, my apologies. 19.1 and 19.2 were approved and acknowledged as part of the consent motion.
Okay, great. So it's just 19.3, 19.4, 19.5.
That's correct.
Okay. So the meeting is now recessed in order for council to consider its closed session business. Committee boardroom CH4A, if you're at City Hall. Members of council, after we recess, we'll move into closed session. You're asked to join the signed closed session virtual meeting if you're not at City Hall. To members of the public watching today's meeting, all meetings of council must start and end in public session. After closed session is completed, council will reconvene in public session to complete its business on today's agenda, including reporting out on any actions arising from its closed session portion of the meeting, passing a confirming bylaw to confirm the proceedings and decisions, and adjourning the meeting. Peter, how 10 minutes require?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, that would be helpful. Thank you.
So let's meet back at 11:49, so we'll reconvene at 12 o'clock in camera.
Council Mayor Brown, we are back. I'm just going to confirm that we do have quorum present. I see Councillor Fortini, Councillor Pelleschi, Councillor Vasante, Councillor Santos.
I'm here too.
Councillor Singh, Councillor Dillon, Councillor Medeiros. So we do have quorum. Mr. Mayor, we can.
Councillor Bowman, we're here.
And okay. Councillor Williams.
In the continuing interest of transparency and open government, I will report in public session any outcomes from today's closed session business. As a result of our closed session today, I wish to report the following. We've already adopted 19.1, 19.2 through consent. That was the closed session minutes. Do we need a motion for those now, or is that already dealt with?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, those were addressed as part of consent approval.
Okay. So that takes us to 19.3. The item was considered in closed session and direction was given to staff. 19.4, the item was considered in closed session, direction was given to staff. And 19.5, the item was considered in closed session and no direction was given to staff.
That's correct. Thank you.
This takes us to confirming bylaws. Our next item, I have a motion moved by Councillor Fortini, seconded by Councillor Medeiros, to approve the confirming bylaw to confirm the proceedings and decisions from today's meeting. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Hearing none, the motion carries. This takes us to adjournment. Council is next scheduled to meet October 28th and Wednesday, November 25th. I have a motion moved by Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Bowman, to adjourn today's meeting. Is anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will count in the affirmative. Hearing none, the motion carries. The meeting is adjourned. Stay safe, stay healthy. Please practice physical distancing and wear a mask or face covering inside public spaces.
Thank you, members of council. This meeting is now over, and the live stream will end momentarily, along with the webcasting.